Pajama Beard 5. I get a gross letter from the beard, and the only solution is to kill it with fire. It has been a measly 72 hours since my last little run-in with Pajama Beard, during which he confessed a rather disturbing fantasy to me. After that run-in, I was a little unsettled. If this guy was crazy enough to say that kind of thing to an almost total stranger, then he may not have any conscience at all, not to take it a step further next time. I decided to provide myself a better means of self-defense. Now, as a note of clarity here, I am by no means a gun nut. I have this gun simply for self-defense and nothing else. The gun in question here is a Smith & Wesson 22 Long Rifle CTG. 22 refers to the caliber, and CTG means a cartridge. And Smith & Wesson is who it's made by, for those who don't already know that. Contrary to what the name may suggest, it's not a rifle, but a revolver. This is what you might call a true lady's gun. 22 is a small caliber round, making it easier for someone with smaller hands and a weaker grip to fire accurately, which is why I own this particular model. Now, the legal age to own a handgun in the lovely state of California is 21, which means it's entirely illegal for me to have this in my possession. But I'm not a total dumbass, and I understand this, so I simply move the gun from a well-hidden spot in my truck where it resides in its case to my nightstand, so it's there, but well out of sight. Doing this makes me feel substantially better, and I'm back to myself in no time. So like I said, it's 3 days later, and I'm feeling good washing sheets and probably inhaling too much Windex while cleaning Kevin 15's windows. Once 15 is clean, I move all the supplies back to the shop and wait for the guests to arrive. Check-in is at 11 a.m, so I end up cleaning the shop's counter and floors. I sell 2 smoked trout in the time I spend waiting, and some poor soul buys a Twix bar that's definitely expired. It's a few minutes before 11 and I hear the door opening. I had been napping since no one had come by for an hour. With a bit of a start, I look up and to my absolute horror, it is Pajama Beard. He's clutching something made of paper in his left hand and in his right a breakfast burrito with more cheese than anything else. There's a good 3/4 of the burrito left and I watch in shock as this hog eats it in 3 huge bites. Looking him over, it almost seems as though he has somehow gained weight. I know he has definitely packed on some pounds since I first met him, but I could have sworn he was heavier than he was even 3 days ago. My nose is then promptly hit with his same unholy scent, and it takes all my willpower not to throw up the rabbit stew I ate for breakfast. "Hello, October. Fancy meeting you here on such a fine day," he is spewing chunks of his breakfast while saying this.
"Hello, PB. Are you here to check in?"
"If only, that would be divine, but your reservations are full until next month, probably because there is someone so beautiful working here." I would call Dan more handsome than beautiful. "And if you're not here to check in, then I cannot talk. I'm working and guests are set to arrive shortly. So whatever it is, please make it snappy." He looks at me then, somewhat disappointed, and proceeds to stretch his left hand out to me. The piece of paper I saw was not actually paper at all, but a sweat-marked sealed envelope. "For you, m'lady." I write about lost it here. No one had ever said that to me before, and it made me want to crawl into a hole and die. I then proceed to reluctantly pluck the letter from his greasy palm, using the thumb and index finger pinch technique. "Thank you, PB. Now, I have to get back to work." Before PB could say anything, his stomach made the loudest sound I'd ever heard a stomach make. You probably could have heard it even standing outside at the pond, that's how loud it was. He laughed slightly.
"I guess 4 wasn't enough."
"4 what?"
4 burritos! I should have gotten 6, just in case, and maybe 3 extra hash brown orders instead of 2.
The burrito I had watched this guy consume was not a small burrito. It looked like a full 1-pound burrito. That means he would have had already eaten 4 pounds worth of burrito, plus 3 servings of hash browns if I'm correct in assuming that he got 1 hash brown with his feast and ordered 2 extra. Or maybe it was 1 hash brown per burrito plus 2 extra, either way. At minimum, this guy had consumed 5 pounds worth of food just for breakfast. And then he was still hungry. Picking out a bit is fine on occasion, like on holidays for example, but having a feast every day is not healthy. Lucky for me, before I could think about this insanity any more than I already had, a young couple appears in the shop doorway. My unknowing hero's presence would save me from the jaws of this obese wolf man. PB looks up and then looks towards me, but I've already begun pulling out the guest book and talking to them. With a big huff, he waddles out, causing the little shop to rock a little as he went. I get the couple checked in and they must have seen the disgust on my face, and they try to make conversation with me to make me feel better.
Their kindness isn't lost on me, and I thank them for showing up when they did and being so nice, and I show my gratitude by giving them the friends and family discount on their entire stay. In the back of my mind, however, is the envelope and how it's still sitting on the counter corner in the bait shop. I want so badly to just leave it there, but I'm also an extremely curious person, and this time my curiosity got the better of me. It's a good time later when I sit down to eat my dinner. I found some really nice porterhouse at the Vaughn's in Bishop, and I have prepared one of them for dinner along with a baked potato and pan-fried asparagus. I sit at my little table eating, and before me sits the Beard's envelope. Using my fishing knife and a napkin, I dissect the envelope, revealing a piece of paper which contains some of the most cryptic and disturbing things I've ever read. I'm sitting there eating my steak, reading the world's most delusioned love letter. Now, I wish I would have taken a picture of it, but it honestly probably violates Reddit's guidelines for even an adult post. Lines like, "I will make you c*** until you bleed," and "if your boyfriend tries to get between us, I'll slice his head off and feast on his corpse," are forever etched into my memory. I would have taken that shit straight to the police if it wasn't for the fact that he was smart enough to type it and not handwrite it, and I doubted anyone would actually believe that I received this, and it wasn't some kind of cry for attention or hoax. But looking back on it, I think the biggest reason I didn't do anything is because it didn't scare me. I honestly found it kind of funny, and I recall laughing while reading it because of how bold and faked his claims and threats were. In that moment, I felt stupid for ever feeling unsettled by this guy, and that night I returned my revolver to its hiding spot in my truck, and even left my doors unlocked. If this fucker wanted to try something with me, I wanted to see him try. The next morning, I woke up nice and early and lit a campfire outside to cook some bacon and eggs on. But my real motive wasn't to have a rustic breakfast. I used that as an excuse to have a fire to burn PB's comical f***ing letter, and have it contribute something useful while doing so. However, much like my patience of PB's bullshit, the love letter, was nothing more than ash in a matter of seconds. In the next installment of the PB encounters, we'll skip forward a bit to my boyfriend's visit and PB's jealous fury.
Thanks for listening, everyone, and have a great day.